Mariner Books and Harper Audio present Big Two-Hearted River, The Centennial Edition by Ernest Hemingway. Foreword by John N. Maclean. Performed by Kyle Soler. Foreword. The Boy, the War, and the Big Two-Hearted River. When I was a youngster, struggling to reconcile a life split between a great community of learning in the Midwest and a log cabin in Montana, my father gave me Ernest Hemingway's Big Two-Hearted River to read. The story came as a revelation. My parents hailed from Montana, where we spent our summers, and they both worked at the University of Chicago. My father as a professor of English, and my mother as an administrator for the university's medical center. Hemingway's tale evoked the core activity of our life in Montana, trout fishing. It put you hip deep in a river with Nick Adams, Hemingway's literary twin, a cold current throbbing against your thighs. You tasted the humidity in the air above the river, a second stream thick with insect life and a sweet musk smell from the enclosing brush. The story virtually put the rod in your hand to fight a big fish. Best of all for me, it bridged the gap between my two worlds and brought trout fishing to life through literature. Hemingway, too, was young and living in contrasting worlds when he wrote Big Two-Hearted River. He was just 25 when he sat down in a Paris cafe to work on a story based on a fishing trip a few years earlier to Michigan's Upper Peninsula, the UP, with two friends, Jack Pentecost and Al Walker. It was a heady time for the young, unproven writer, who had joined writers and artists of what came to be called the Lost Generation, along with the likes of F. Scott Fitzgerald, Pablo Picasso, and Man Ray, as well as older artists like Ezra Pound and Gertrude Stein, who became his surrogate parents. His personal life, too, was packed with challenge and adventure. He had been wounded only a few years earlier as a Red Cross volunteer in Italy during the Great War, recuperated and returned home, gone fishing in the UP, married and moved to Paris with his new wife, Hadley Richardson, followed quickly by the birth of a son, Jack, or Bumby, and discovered a passion for bullfighting. Hemingway wrote in cafes for the quiet. The fishing story he started with three handwritten pages in a large, almost flowery script on typewriter stock, grew in halting stages, interrupted by other work and a trip to Spain for the bullfighting. As the drafts progressed, the two buddies disappeared, and instead Nick Adams set off on a solo pilgrimage to ease a troubled mind with a fly rod. The exact timing for when he wrote each part is hard to pin down. Hemingway couldn't recall it himself, and the drafts aren't dated. But from accounts by him and others, it appears he completed part one and was well into part two by late spring of 1924, before he headed to Pamplona for the running of the bulls. "The story was interrupted, you know, just when I was going good," he complained in a letter that fall. When he got back to it in late summer or early fall, he'd lost the flow. In the new draft, Hemingway veered from the solo fishing trip in the UP into a long, rambling discourse on writing, writers, bullfighting in Pamplona, and vaulting personal ambition. He wanted to become a great writer, he wrote. He was pretty sure he would be. By the fall of 1924, Hemingway had completed a manuscript, titled it Big Two-Hearted River, and sent it off to a publisher for inclusion in his first real book, In Our Time. He showed the manuscript to Stein, who said of the discourse on writing, "Hemingway, remarks are not literature." Jolted back to his old self, he reread the section at issue and called it crap, and worse in letters to her and others. "I got a hell of a shock when I realized how bad it was," he wrote one correspondent. He ditched the almost 10-page section and had a new ending in the hands of his publisher before the presses rolled. It was a lucky catch. Critics would not have been kind. The redone story first appeared in May 1925 in This Quarter, a Paris literary journal, and then in October as the anchor story for In Our Time. Despite complaints that nothing happens in the narrative, perceptive readers such as Edmund Wilson and F. Scott Fitzgerald hailed it as a masterpiece, albeit a short one. Because Big Two-Hearted River is poetry. A century on, Big Two-Hearted River has helped shape language and literature in America and around the world, and its magnetic pull continues to draw readers, writers, and critics. It's the best early example of Hemingway's now familiar writing style: short sentences, punchy nouns and verbs, few adjectives or adverbs, and a seductive cadence. Easy to imitate, difficult to match. The subject matter of the story has inspired generations of writers to believe that fly fishing can be literature, with mixed results. More than any of his stories, it depends on his iceberg theory of literature, the notion that leaving essential parts of a story unsaid adds to its power. Taken in context with his other work, it marks Hemingway's passage from boyish writer to accomplished author. Nothing big came before it. Novels and stories poured out after it. After my dad gave me the story to read in the 1950s, we sat down together to analyze it. We were both deeply pleased that fishing and literature could be successfully combined, and in future decades, we would strive to do the same thing as writers. But we stumbled over the meanings of the dark metaphors that begin and end the story. Big Two-Hearted River is not simply a luminous fishing tale. It's also an unsolved mystery. Like the title, the story has two sides: an outdoor adventure and the never-explained metaphors that accompany it, which have kept critics arguing ever since. As the narrative opens, Nick Adams steps off a train and discovers to his surprise that the old logging town of Seney has been burned over. Just what the scorched earth stands for is never stated, but it's not utter destruction. It could not all be burned, Nick reflects as he hikes beyond the fire's black footprint into a meadow carpeted with sweet ferns and marked by hillocks with still-standing pines. The great fires of the late 19th and early 20th centuries burned across the North Woods, supercharged by the wasteful logging practices of the day. Huge swaths of white pine were clear-cut, and towns built on foundations of sawdust, perfect beds for the flames that followed, which indeed gutted several towns. Stumps from the logging remain visible to this day, poking up among the ferns. Several smaller fires burned around Seney just before Hemingway's 1919 trip, and he almost certainly walked through their black footprints. In the story, as Nick shoulders his pack and sets off, he struggles with unnamed but troubling thoughts, hiking longer than necessary to deaden his mind and make sleep come more easily. He becomes absorbed in details of the moment as he makes camp, catches and loses fish, and explores his surroundings. As he watches trout rise, his spirit rises with them. He's repeatedly described as being happy, as though that too were a surprise. Then, after a day of fishing that includes a battle with the biggest trout he's ever seen, Nick faces a cedar swamp with deep, swirling currents, a dark place similar to the burned landscape where the story began. The fishing would be tragic, he tells himself, and repeats the thought. In the swamp, fishing was a tragic adventure. Nick.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.